Hi, I'm Andrew Wasson from Creative Guitar Studio. Thanks for joining me for another one of my guitar lessons. This time around, we're going to go out to Norway, where Erik wrote in, and he says here, I really like the sound of arpeggios. Bands I like to listen to seem to use a lot of them. My favorite styles are definitely those that use the neoclassical sound. Could you make a guitar lesson on building arpeggio stacks? If I knew how this worked and had some good guitar neck shapes, I'm positive that I could use arpeggios much better. Well, thanks for writing in, Erik. You know, arpeggios can be overlaid or stacked into arrangements on the guitar both vertically as well as horizontally. Plus, these arpeggio shapes can also be built into arrangements that move through various harmonic qualities. So in other words, this process could be applied where a single arpeggio is moved into upper octaves spread over or across the guitar fretboard within one chord type, or arpeggios could be grouped in with several harmonies. In short, there are a couple of angles for you to approach this from. But first, let's get acquainted with the music theory involved in the construction of stacking the scale tones into harmony. In looking at the theory of stacking tones on top of one another and then stacking the triads and the sevenths on top of one another to gain these overlaid arpeggios, what I've done is I've gone through a triad of C major. I've extended it one note further by adding upon the C, E, G. I've taken a B note and added that on top to create a C major 7. And then on top of the C, E, G, B, now I've added a D note as well, and that created an extended chord of C major 9. But the main thing I want to look at with you is how, when you stack them, you're actually gaining other arpeggio possibilities. So obviously, in the C major 7, we do have the C major triad. It exists there already. But I want to focus on something different. I want to focus on, from respect from the E note, and take a look at these tones here, the EGB, which is actually an E minor arpeggio, or chord. So E minor, arpeggios and chords, of course, same thing as arpeggios, a broken chord. So there's an E minor triad existing within the C major 7. That's what I mainly want to get across here in breaking this down. When we go further, of course, inside the C major 9, we, of course, have the C major triad, the C, on top of the C, the E note forms our E minor that we saw in the C major 7. But we can take things a step further off of that E note, and we can do an analysis from E, G, B, D, which extends that original E minor triad out a step further into the realms of E minor 7. So an E minor 7 chord exists inside of a C major 9, but it doesn't have to stop there. Because we've extended things out to the D, we can also do an analysis from G, B, and D, which of course, if you're familiar with your chord construction, that's a G major triad. So just from building and stacking on top of a C note going in thirds, of course, that's how we would construct chords, we wound up with quite a few chords in front of us. We have larger extended chords like the C major 9. We have chords like, you know, E minor 7, C major 7. But we also have those smaller triads in between like the E minor triad and, of course, the G major triad. So you can start to see the overall advantage of the stacking of tones and overlaying triad upon triad upon triad gives you some pretty cool possibilities. So let's jump over to the guitar neck next, and I'd like to go over a few examples that I've put together to help you to put this stuff into action.
In the following examples that I have for the guitar, we're going to examine arpeggios that stay true to the quality and true to the root, as well as arpeggios that shift from one quality and root over to another. So for instance, in example number one, I'm going to be covering the sound of an A minor triad with an arpeggio that moves both vertically and horizontally from the root beginning upon sixth string to an octave at fourth, and then finally to another root that's in a second octave higher at the second guitar string. So here we go. This is example number one, A minor arpeggio. Okay, here it is again. Again. Okay. Now in example number two, I've overlaid three different seventh quality arpeggio types on top of one another in one position vertically. So I'm basically in the fifth and sixth position more or less here, dealing with a B flat, a D minor 7, and F major 7. All of them are seventh quality chords. And I'm going to outline them intermixed, performing ideas using, you know, this diatonic harmony. In this case, we're in the key of F major. So you can achieve some pretty cool sounds in key if you use this type of approach. So here we go, nice and slow. This is example number 2. And here it is a little faster. Now, in example number 3, I've mixed both the seventh quality chords along with triads in a line that operates basically horizontally, shifting along the upper 3 string sets. You'll hear this type of sound in many different musical styles, so check it out. It's very effective. It goes like this. Okay, here it is a little bit faster. And it's just covering the sounds of D minor, E dominant seventh, and then we've got B flat major, C major. It winds up resolving into an A pitch at the end there at 14th fret of third string. Now finally, in example number 4, I've included a fun fingerboard shape of the diminished seventh arpeggio. I just had to throw this one in for the fans of the neoclassical style. But keep in mind, this arpeggio sound is certainly not limited to neoclassical. For instance, jazz guitarist Wes Montgomery was a big time user of this arpeggio. I've taken it over 2 octaves, traveling both vertical and horizontal. Plus, I'd like to state that this arpeggio is symmetrical, so every note of it can act as a possible root. Anyhow, here is the last example, the diminished seventh arpeggio, from example number 4 in your handout. Here it is again. So if you enjoy the sound of arpeggios and you can spend enough time practicing both sevenths and triad shapes across the guitar or fingerboard, you'll notice a very cool group of new sounds showing up in your melodies and solos. It takes time, you know, to first get decent at every arpeggio, but eventually you'll find your favorite shapes, and once these stacked arpeggio lines are under your fingers, moving quite freely, both vertically, horizontally, and then overlaid atop of one another, either inside of a chord, of course, like we discussed, or working outside that quality. You'll enjoy a great many new sounds to use in your guitar playing. It's a bit of work, but it really pays off in the end. Anyway, once again, thanks for watching. Have fun working on this stuff. You can download the handout and the MP3 jam track for this lesson over at my website at andrewwasson.com. You can follow me on Twitter, through Facebook, and on my other guitar blog YouTube channel. The links are all in the description box below for you. Take care, everybody, and I'll see you next time. Bye for now.